Welcome back. Thank you. This is the moment, as the song goes. The accolades keep on coming to Dr. Jean Houston. She is on the cover of Science of Mind magazine. She was voted the spiritual hero of the year. Quite an honor. So I wondered how I could capture the essence of Jean and her work. And I looked at some of the words that she uses. Her vocabulary is expansive, manifesting, attracting, connecting, or just identifying what is. She encourages us to seek abundance in many forms, to search for the beloved in many ways, to embrace the mythical life, to tap into spiritual energy, to derive meaning from nature, and participate in rituals as gateways to deeper truths. It's quite a background. These are the times that we were created for, and Dr. Jean Houston wants us to be ready for them. So please give a warm inside welcome to Dr. Jean Houston.
Oh, my. Well, what a pleasure it is to be back. How many times have I been here? Does anybody know? A lot. 9, 10? Not, oh my. 20, no. Would that it were so, yes. And to be here on this tremendous occasion of 25 years old, you finally grew up as an organization. That's wonderful. So, I don't know where this title came from, but it seems to be appropriate. Baffled No More. Because it's a new speech, little pieces of it I'm going to have to read, and then a lot, we will actually do a lot of work together. Let me just check on the time. Oh, my, actually, I'm early. You want the mic really close. All right. So one of the things that I said in my announcement, I said that you are haunted by a specter, the grand finale of the world as you have known it. How many of you would agree with that weird statement? Yeah. One of the things I like to say is we have all lived in the good times. We're now in the great times. And you can take that any way you want. Because we are the people of the parenthesis. We are at the end of one era. We're not quite at the beginning of the new one. And the time of parenthesis is the time in which the future is seeded and coded. You know, many of you have labored in your various fields to make things better. How many of you can say you've really been doing that? Yes? And yet you are trying to understand the change of which you are a part, an incredible change. Other times in history thought they were it. They're wrong. This is it. This is it, you know. I mean, the most implausible, improbable series of happenings ever. The maps no longer fit the territory. The territory is now dimensional. It's multidimensional. It's dimensional in the many, many levels of ourselves and all of the different worlds outside and around us. And I'm going to say it right up front, folks. What I am proposing for you, how you like that? Isn't it nice to have somebody give you your marching orders? The choiceless choice. What I am proposing for you for this new year of 2011 is that we learn to act in the service of what is emerging. This means that we become capable of deeper seeing, deeper sensing, deeper knowing, deeper being. We become capable of being available to the presence of the spirit of becoming. We are in a radically new time. The reset button of history has been hit. Brand new story. Brand new story. How many of you have lived hundreds of years in the last 10 years? How many of you are more or less 843 years old? And you are. I mean, I say this as a joke, but this is actually true. Most of you, many of you here, have lived anywhere between 5 to 10 to 100 times the amount of sheer experience of your ancestor of 150 years ago. I mean, they may have crossed the country like mine did. They crossed the country in a covered wagon. If you could have seen them, you would have known why the wagon was covered. I I sometimes, actually very often, I attend conferences of very high-minded folk from many, many disciplines who address the problems of an old world passing into the new in their lifetime. It used to be when a new world was coming in, at least it was nice about it. It took 250 years, not just a few months. And the many, many challenges of this incredible new millennium has brought many to the table. Some are radical visionaries. Let's just clean it all up, get rid of the lousy bum. Others are reformers devoted to redressing old wrongs. Each attempts to try to open up the membrane, you know, almost the birth cowl of that is wrapping us in unknowing. And with all their practical skill, and I deal with an awful lot of people with many, many skills, and even with all their accomplishments, they are humble before the mystery of a world in transition. You are living on the stage of radical history. I remember an Italian member who was Italian officials at the United Nations, and she said, "Hey, I can get away with this accent because I'm half Sicilian. Okay, it's as if we're all in a giant womb, and we're trying to figure out what happens next." And I was so startled by her remark because that morning I had been driven by a Bulgarian cab driver trying to find a Kinko's copy, and he said to me, "I have just been present at the birth of my daughter. I was very afraid. I'd never seen such a thing. It was very messy and very beautiful. And after all the hours of my wife's labor and painful contractions, a new life. Maybe that's what's trying to happen in this world. A new life." I often think of my work as a kind of midwifery. Organizations, cultures, countries, businesses, as well as individuals, seem to need a kind of steadying hand as they birth themselves into a world as strange and as unexpected as the babies must face when they emerge from the womb, yes? But how do you do it? How do you grow to become stewards of the extraordinary time that is upon us? And in so doing, not only nurture ourselves, our clients, our cultures. Well, one of the ways is to realize really where we are in the whole system transition that is of which we're a part. A condition of interactive change, my friends, that affects literally every aspect of life that we have known it. Never before in history has there been interactive change on every possible level happening in months and not in decades or hundreds of years. Okay? Now, in one of my books, I called it jump time. And jump time relates to evolutionary biology, where you watch a species as it grows, and you see it in the rocks, the fossils, and it goes la da 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 da, hundreds, thousands, sometimes tens of thousands of years, and then suddenly, whoop, it jumps. It becomes something different. So we are in the same place. Living, a species will jump when it is living at the edge of its tolerance. How many of you think we're living at the edge of our tolerance? And experience sufficient ferment and stress. How many of you are experiencing sufficiency of ferment and stress? Nobody here? No, I didn't think so. Okay. But what that does is it punctuates the equilibrium with a sudden jump to a whole new order of being. So friends, genius. What is genius? I've known a few geniuses. And when I sat down and really found out why you're a genius, genius was the way that they found out of particular difficult situations they had to become a genius. Well, this is true of all of us. Many of us find that our depths are rising, our spirits are quickening, shaking, all kinds of ideas, dreams, thoughts we never thought to have are rising in us. It is as if it is the first level of genius becoming democratic. Across many, many people, many nations, men and women, and that's very important. And of course, people of all kinds of different ethnicities. Perhaps the most important thing that is happening in human history ever, or at least for the last 5,000 years, is the rise of women to full, partnership with men in the whole domain of human affairs, which is changing everything. And I'll tell you the dirty secret that nobody is talking about. When you go around the world and you see who is doing the work, who is innovating, who is calling the causes, who is following through, it's 70-80% are women of a certain age. Postmenopausal zest is no mere metaphor. And nobody's writing about it because they're, you know, they don't want to break. But this is what's happening. And this is not putting men down. This is releasing men to finally be what they can be and no longer being disrupted or paralyzed within same old, same old. It's releasing the poetry, the art, the spiritual genius of men. It is a phenomenal thing. Father Joe, would you agree, Father Joseph Franciscan? You totally agree with me. Well, the Franciscan monk agrees with me, so it must be true. Okay. So it literally is the breakdown and the breakthrough of every kind of way of being, knowing, relating, governing, belief. It is shaking the foundations of all and everything, and it is allowing for another order of reality to come into time. Now, throughout history, these kinds of jumps, cultural jumps, have occurred, but what is now happening that has never been known before is a collective worldwide jump, faster and more complex than anything the world has known. We are in the midst of the most massive shift of perspective humankind has ever known. This is so huge. I mean, you see what is unique in our human history, get beneath all the patterns of chaos. And we realize that we are at the rare choice point, both for the world and for ourselves. All the current movements of change are accelerating radically new happenings in social and structural development, complexity, behavioral variety, awareness. There is literally a multi-level transformation of our entire nature at the work. And it's also going to affect the nature and function of societies. What we think of societies today is going to look nothing like societies 30 years from now. What seems to be happening is the beneath the surface crust of collective consciousness, we are moving into a planetary civilization with high individuation of culture. And the birth pangs are enormous. I mean, my old friend Barbara Marx Hubbard and I used to have this little joke many years ago where we said, what would a fetologist make about being in the womb? A little tiny fetologist, you know, and there in the womb watching. Oh, nice ocean. So sweet. It's very nice. What's that little creature? Little fish. Ah, hello, fish. Yeah, no, looks like an amphibian. Oh, my. Getting larger and larger. There's no room for me. Getting, well, now the walls are cracking. It's death. No, it's birth. And that's what's happening now. We are in the huge birth pangs of the human species as it relates to the stewardship of the planet. Now, just take one thing. I'm going to take a couple of issues and just look at them. Everywhere I go, I see young people texting. I think, you know, they have callous transcendental thumbs because they're looking for connection. I mean, God forbid they have to look at each other, but their thumb. If you think it's just them, my friend Deepak Chopra lives on his BlackBerry, and he writes all his books, and his thumb's going all the time. He has a direct connection from God through his brain into his thumb, you know, and that's how he gets it all done. But a lot of what is happening is this whole new order, which is the prefigural event of connectivity as we literally become a planetary society. And, you know, old fogies like you and me can look at this and say, but where's literature? Where's philosophy? Where's romance? Where's face-to-face? Well, it's in a denouement for a while. And then it's going to emerge in a fascinating new way. Everything is shifting. Now, let me give you some, and if I were to talk about the five main shifts, is the regenesis of human nature. That is happening now. Human nature is shifting. That we are all in this incredible process in which the depths of ourselves are arising in ways they never could before. We are dreaming each other's dream. We are sensing each other's. Radical empathy has become the name of the game. the dreams of other cultures, the dreams of other people. We are catching each other in ways we never could before. And because of all the great shift, not only are the depths rising within ourselves, but the depths are rising in societies. My claim to fame is I'm one of the best traveled human beings who's ever lived. I've worked in over 100 countries and deeply in some 40 cultures. I was trained by Margaret Mead, who was my adopted mother, and she sent me all over the world to study these shifts, and this is back in the 1970s. Now, what is happening in these shifts is that we are gaining leaky margins to each other. It happened with the television, with the internet, and now it is happening within ourselves. The membrane has stopped. That's something else, the breakdown of the membrane. The breakdown of the membrane, not just between peoples and nations, with it a huge backlash necessarily, yes? It's like there's a terrible backlash with the rise of women, and thus you have your Al-Qaedas, etc. But at the same time, we are coming to be not encapsulated bags of skin dragging around dreary little egos. We are organism environments. We have become symbiotic with each other in ways we never were before. One of the beauties of this extraordinary organization, the Inside Edge, is that it allows people to meet empathically, humorously. Always start meeting each other humorously, and then empathy is sure to follow. And then the great seeding of rich and fertile, potent and potentiating ideas. By God, you people are good. Now we understand so much more about the human brain, mind, psyche system as we have never understood before. And we discover that, in fact, we are God seeds. We are coded with the cosmos, the universe. We don't just live in the universe lives inside of ourselves. Go into meditative states or different states of consciousness or just relax and be with nature, and everything is right available to bring you home. How many of you meditate, pray, dance with dogs? That's my big thing. Really spend time remembering yourself. Remembering. And because you see, it isn't just about you. Once we were in outer space and saw ourselves, I had something to do with that NASA experiment 1,000 years ago, but really saw the Earth back there, we were no longer just her child, we were her great friend and associate. And we were getting prepared in this little corner of the universe, at the outer wing of the universe, the outer wing of a galaxy. We're not in the center where all the fancy stuff is going on. We're an outer wing. This is the skunk works, friends. This is where you put your experimental lab. This is God's school. This is where you're being prepped for the next stage, which probably is to become responsible for evolutionary governance, taking care of the planet, and then you're being prepped probably for the solar system, and then you're being prepped probably, if I may give you a science fiction story that I think is coming true, you are being prepped for the galactic milieu. I sometimes wonder all these things that all my friends see that I've never seen, these, you know, little ships and all rising around. It's either the high school field trip on this planet, or it's the local Las Vegas of the universe, you know, betting on whether we're going to make it or not. But anyway, however it is, and we're getting closer and closer. This is God's school. This is where we have a sufficiency of chaos, turbulence, challenge, love, radical empathy, innovation, catastrophe that really hones our pluck, our cunning, allows for the depths to rise, and allows us to enter into our full humanity. Okay? All right, now, I want to give you some very strange good news. Was anybody here alive in 1950? Okay, well, a few people, okay. We call it the 60-year explosion. I got it from my friend Tim Noble, but so what's happened since 1950, 51? Human population has almost tripled to 6.8 billion. Average years of education of this tripled population has increased from 3.2 years, is what it was in 1950, to 7.8 years worldwide. The rate is increasing. 6.7% of the global population, 455 million people, hold four-year college degrees or higher. Of that number, over 60%, and this is in Arab countries as well, over 60% are women. In countries like Kuwait, it's 70-75% are women. Bahrain, Dubai, Kuwait. Okay. More women than men the world over are taking advanced degrees in master's and PhDs. 75% of the women, of the managers are women, but they still are not allowed to be at the very top. That's changing. Our global domestic product has increased 14 times, from 5 trillion to 70 trillion. Our agricultural productivity per person has increased by 20%. Knowledge in physics, mathematics, biology, astronomy, computer science, material science, the social science has expanded so much I don't even have a figure. It's beyond our understanding. So much so that by the year 2040, our present science will be only 5% of what the science will be in the year 2040. Tools for learning, for communicating, for collaborating, for organizing, for researching, for manufacture have improved beyond our ability to comprehend the increase. It's the creation of a new civilization. A seventh grade student can have more computing power and more access to information in her backpack than would all the governments, global corporations, institutions had in 1950. Okay? We 6.8 billion people constitute an enormous pool of informed and connected consciousness far larger than any ever previously existed in human experience. And it is, some of you know that as a child, I walked with an old man who I called Mr. Teilhard, who turned out to be Teilhard de Chardin, who lived across the street from me on 84th Street and Park Avenue. Ah, Jean, the people of your time, they will be taking the tiller of the world, but it will be all connected. It will be the noosphere. Oh, Jean, you must touch every culture, every people, otherwise it will not happen. We are in the noosphere. We are living in what he saw in 1955. So, wisdom. Yes, wisdom. See, the problem is you watch Fox News or the other end, CNN. It doesn't make any difference. We are being scared to death by our media for economic purposes. There is an immense amount of knowing that is very different. Wisdom has increased. The enormous number of women and men, thinkers, scholars, philosophers, the many, many paths that they are all, that we are all researching and pondering. We have arriving at answers and solutions, many of which are now field-tested and ready to implement. This is why we're going to see whole system transition in all of our social forms. The regenesis of our societies is really right there behind us. The breakdown of the membrane, the breakthrough of the depths, the spirit is rising, the Zeit is getting geisty. I won't even ask how many Jewish, Buddhists, Sufis who also tap dance are here, because I know you're right. The divine delicatessen is no mere metaphor, you know. As you really find your way into spiritual process, spiritual practice that you could not have had before. When, excuse me, Father, close your ears. When it was in my childhood, Holy Mary, Mother of God, save us, there's now for the hour of our death. I might, you know, and I didn't know what I was saying. Now Mary is Saraswati, and she's Kuan Yin, and it's this great female, you know, surge of herself. Herself, Father, isn't it true? Herself is part of the great divine mystery now. Yes, indeed. I'm so sorry. The problem is that when I was 6 years old, Sister Teresa gave me 300 million years in purgatory for asking if Jesus ever had to go to the bathroom, and I have never stopped kidding Catholics ever since. The other question was, Sister Teresa, when Jesus rose, was that because God filled him full of helium, you know? Okay. All right. Who was Catholic here? Who still is? Four. Okay. Well, that. Ah, sure. You put women in as priests, you'll have no more problems. Really? I mean, I sometimes think, excuse me, I can't help but being blasphemous, but if the three wise men had been three wise women, you know, they would have brought a casserole. They would have helped with the birth. They would have made very nice, you know, things. They would make sure the baby was washed and, you know, and all things. They would have attended to the family, right? Anyway, I mean, what does a baby need with gold, frankincense, and myrrh? You chose to sit in the front row. I can't help you. So in 60 years, we have become very rich, very wise, very competent, beyond our ability to measure or comprehend. As my friend Tim Noble says, our wealth, capability, and knowledge have increased so rapidly and so radically that the extremity of the scale of the increase and the implications of the scale of the increase have not registered in our social awareness. Now, this is very important. We have been in a negative trance as opposed to a positive enchantment. We identify bad things much more quickly. We identify with threats much more quickly and urgently than we identify opportunities. How many of you are in the airport getting scanned in the most interesting ways? As well as, you know, the threat has risen to orange. You know, what is the reason for this? Why this negative trance? Part of it is simply biological. We have a very old brain back there. You have a mid-sized brain and you've got a new brain, and they don't particularly talk to each other. They just scare the business out of you. Look, you grew up in trees millions of years ago. You were all in trees. What do you suppose was happening on the ground? There you are living in the trees, and there's the animals that are trying to get you. That's why you still look under the bed for the boogies. It's true. You know, it's why that the fear is beneath the surface crust of consciousness all the time. But we also have the new brain, and we have the emotional brain that allows us to mediate that. But unfortunately, there is a radical need in our time for a new natural philosophy based on our new knowledge of the cosmos, which loves us, the world, which loves us, the cross-cultural mix of knowledge and understanding, a potential evolutionary direction which we have in our hands right now, and our own emerging realities. We have been shackled for too long by philosophies, however noble, that have been limited by much narrower views of the world. And what is worse, there is no one here who has not been patterned and prepared in the alembic of these limited views, however out of date they may be. Each one of us has been marinated in the medieval soup of the mind. And we're very vinegary, I can tell you, you know. So in our incredible time, when literally everything is in transition, we can no longer afford to live as archaic and remedial members of the human race. A new set of values, holistic, syncretic, relationship, process-oriented, organic, spiritual, is rising within us and around us. We're still scared to death, and we love, you know, the quasi-erotic frisson of danger. You know, that's just why you have so many interesting movies that scare you half to death. We enjoy it because it appeals to that old brain, you see. But at the same time, something else is trying to happen. Though old forces and traditions and fears and negative trances seek to restrain us, we know there is no going back. Our complex time requires a wiser use of our capacities, a richer music from the instrument we have been given. The world will thrive only if we can grow. The possible society will become a reality only if we learn to become the possible humans that we have within us. We are the pilgrims and the parents of this emerging new world, and no old formulas and stopgap solutions will do. They will not. I think of that magnificent woman, Frances Moore LaPay. How many of you know about her? It's extraordinary. And she says in her a new book preface to Getting a Grip Too, I realize that the humanity has no excuses anymore. You know, we know how to end this needless suffering. We have all the resources to do it. That's my main theme. We have all the resources to do it. No obstacle is stopping us. Nothing. The barrier is in our own heads. We are creating this world gone mad because of ideas we hold. Our ideas about reality determine what we see, what we believe is possible, and therefore what we become. And we also know that the human being can change through our big life-shaping ideas. Let's take poverty, for example. This is me now talking. I have a friend by the name of Lester Brown. How many of you know who Lester Brown? And what was he head of? Come on. Win-win economics, what else? No. But he could have been, yeah. No, what he has been doing is doing this extraordinary work in really looking at what is happening everywhere in economics and climate and people's situation. And he has a book out called, Earth 4.0, that's the new one. And he covers everything. And he is absolutely knowing everything and all the problems. He's totally positive. I don't wonder. He's also something of a mystic. So his inward journey allows him then to take the inward extraordinary amplification of knowing and ways of knowing and look at the world. And what he is saying, and he's probably one of the most astute people alive today, and he's always looking at the world from many perspectives. Now, this is very important, because if you read the newspaper, cold print, you're going to get a very limited perspective. If you see it, if you touch it, if you think it, if you dance it, if you smell it, if you eat it, if you taste it, if you run any issue through the multiple senses then and ways of knowing that you have. How many of you think in images? Let me see. How many of you think in words? How many of you think with the whole body? How many great sniffers are here? How many tasters, like Proust, you know, you eat a cookie and here comes the remembrance of things past. Yes. How many street smart people are here? How many think with their hearts? How many think intuitively? How many frequency picker-uppers are? You see, you have all these different forms. Run an issue through these other sensory forms, and you're going to have a very different reality. You're going to have a multifaceted, multi-form reality. Well, that's the way he is. So he's always looking at the world from many perspectives, including, as I said, from his rich inner life and development. And he tells us, we have the means right now, in the next few years, to end poverty forever. It will cost, he says, $190 billion. That's all. You know what $190 billion is? It's less than 0.3% of our $70 trillion of the world GDP. The point is that our wealth, our competence, is so enormous that a minute action of it could fund most programs to effectively address the most pressing problems of our species. Why do we not do it? Negative trance. Our fear-based modes of interacting, organizing, and education are suppressing or diverting most of the energy, creativity, and productivity of all people. You thought I was going to be nice and silly here. Are on both personal and social levels, our energy is diverted from productive support of life and used instead in activities of attack, defense, control, and mass distraction. 10 or 15 years ago, when I used to drive in California, the streets were nice. Now it's bumpity, 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 bumpity. I mean, literally, we have whole system all over the country, systemic breakdown. What's going on here? And how much does these major bombs that are every day cost? Okay. How do we have an economics of sustainable abundance? There's a word in Italian that is much better than abundance. Abundance. It's abundance with a joy, with the spirit, with the many levels of abundance. Abundance! If we can see the reality that we are capable of abundance, of almost immediately entering extreme global poverty, put in powerful programs to both stop and reverse the deterioration of the Earth's life support systems, that we can trigger startup energy for implementing global sustainability and abundance for all, we have to awaken from the negative trance. Now, my whole life is training leaders at every possible level and people everywhere to awaken from the negative trance. In fact, for those of you who are interested, my big mystery school, which is coming up pretty soon here, is going to be the first one. And you can take single ones rather. The whole thing is going to be on waking up from the negative trance, getting over the barriers of the fear, so that suddenly you have all these sources and resources of energy and ideas available to you. It's a big one. And my study over many years of hundreds of people who have made a difference, often pointed to their ability to sense, to see, to touch, to feel the emerging reality and to align their bodies and their minds in harmony with this. And from this alignment comes the ideas, the innovations, the solutions to all their projects, regardless of the nature of the project, be it related to invention, the arts, health, spirituality, whatever. We live in the field of being, in which all answers and solutions, past, present, and future, exist. But how to reach this? What are the access keys? What are the codes? As the great noted economist W. Brian Arthur of Santa Fe Institute says, every profound innovation is based on an inward-bound journey, on going to a deeper place where knowing comes to the surface. And this journey is the heart of what I try to teach. It is to explore and develop those ways to engender the passion for the possible while knowing what that possible is. And in so doing, we discover ways of transcending and transforming the local self so that extraordinary life can arise, both in the inner world as well as our outer world, and to find out that, yes, you really can make a difference. There is no question, but this huge, huge, larger life is latent in the human species, and we only live a very tiny part of the life that we've been given. We can't get away with it anymore. It is time to grow or die, you know. So it requires of you who are serious about making a difference something that astronauts and sports people and great artists and inventors and mystics and social artists and co-creators always open and available to the acquiring of the greater nature that is equal to the tasks and challenges of today. And just the way 60 years ago we had only a small fraction of the understanding of our planet and the ability to find the resources, we now also, 60 years later, have enormous access to the greater nature that lies within. How do you do it? You agree, first of all, and this is a hard one, to relinquish those limited and limiting patterns of body, sensory and motor patterns, emotion, volition, intelligence, understanding, and of spirit that have been keeping you from becoming all you can be. You stop spending years in dry dock or in the desert realm of yourself on hold, waiting for that person to come along to call you forth, asking for someone to waken you from the negative trance. You know you contain it. Stop it. Stop it. You're boring God. And allowing yourself to instead become available to the extraordinary dimensions that each of you contains for a much larger life in body, mind, and spirit. And that is what I absolutely believe that is required of us if we're going to help our era survive and grow. There is, if you would be open to it, friends, there is a multi-level transformation of your entire nature in the works, as well as in the very nature and function of society. We are at the rare choice point, both for the world and ourselves. Allowing yourself to become available to the extraordinary dimension that each of you contains for a much larger life in body, mind, and psyche. But you got to believe it. It's there. I'm going to start. I'm going to do a few exercises for you. Sometimes we need guidance patterns, yes? Okay. Everybody's gotten thrilled by this new stuff about the butterflies, you know. You have a caterpillar. Okay. It gets itself in a cocoon. If it doesn't get eaten by a bird, and it just is in that cocoon, and what happens? It becomes mush. Mush. How out of this horrible mush could the butterfly arise? How out of the mush of today's social structures can the butterfly of the new society emerge? And what happens is something called the imaginal cells. Imaginal cells. Cells that are loaded with becoming. Cells that are potent with a new life form. And one imaginal cell in the bush says, "Hey there!" And a long way away, like a half an inch, the other man, "Hello! Can we connect? All right. Oh, there he is. There's Joe. Oh, my God. Look, there's Father Joe as an imaginal cell. Oh, boy. What are we going to eat? What are we going to eat? We're going to eat the mush. Ah, the mush says, no, you're not. We're going to stay a caterpillar. We're going to stay a caterpillar. No, we're going to eat you. We're going to co-create a whole new design of possibility. Out pops the butterfly. Lives lightly on the earth. Pollinates is beautiful. That's us. But we're in the mush phase. Now, what has happened in the inside edge for 25 years is the imaginal cells have been shouting. May I have an imaginal cell from here shout across, please? But call them, call them. I'm going to give you an imaginal cell exercise. Are you ready? I want you to know that each one of you has higher guidance. I call it the entelechy, the divine, productive, creative, purposive self that is calling you into being. It is the entelechy of an acorn to be, an oak tree. It's the entelechy of a popcorn kernel to be, a popcorn. It's the entelechy of a baby to be. It is the entelechy of you when you start to relate to your second or higher destiny. A lot of you have lived out your first destiny. Now this is the big one that is correspondent with the greatness of the time. Hegel writes about world historical individuals, people whose particular passion is in alignment with the passion and the turning of the time. Out in front or behind the scenes, they become the entrepreneurs of progress, the ones who lead the higher process. If you agree to it, that's you. It's not just special people. It's not the man on the horse. It is you and me, okay? But you meet the entelechy. Would you stand up, please? Now, this is serious standing up. If you can find a little room, get a little room. I want you to put your hands out so. Eyes close. And you may call this a healing fiction, whatever you call it, it works. And no pictures, please, during this. I want you to imagine, would you turn the music on, please? Part 7, the music that I asked for. I want you to imagine that standing opposite you is your high self, your essential being. Yourself as if you'd had 1,000 years to develop. That high self, that God self, the God-seated being, the essential being, the entelechy, who's looking upon you with so much love, with such cherishing, and who loves you so much. And just feel yourself basking in the gaze of this high being, who knows your unskilled behaviors, who knows your glories, your failures, your great yearnings and wanderings, and is looking upon you with such encouragement. and you feel yourself seen, known, encouraged, admired, called forth, loved into being. And this IntelliKey is igniting your evolutionary beingness, igniting the imaginal cells, if you will, within you of this higher destiny that is yours, so that on the most basic cellular as well as the highest metaphysical level, you are being called and you're being re-frequenced, re-genetic-sized into a new order of being. And you have looked upon with such love, the IntelliKey looking upon you with such love, such cherishing, such deep seeing. You are being honored, empowered, acknowledged, ignited, loved into the fullness of your being. And it may be that you can even feel this IntelliKey who will call the IntelliKey the great friend. And the great friend is there as the deep, deep companion of your life and has regarded you as the fullness that is coming into time, the one who is being coded, given access to the highest forms of your becoming. Know yourself so deeply seen, known, encouraged, you are being acknowledged and affirmed, and loved into the higher order of your being. And from this moment forth, if you choose and if you agree, this great high presence who you can dialogue with, be with, is there as your great accompaniment, your great friend who accompanies you, helps provide you with new pathways, with new ways of being, with a becoming that transcends almost anything you've known before, who opens up the veils of the world and gives you paths and possibilities that are yours now, especially with the help of this higher, greater mind, this essential self who sees the world in its becomings and leads you to your most creative and potent pathways. Regardless of your age, regardless of your station, you are now deeply, deeply in alignment with those things, with those realities that are bringing us into the kingdom, so that you can begin to live in the kingdom you are being and not in the outskirts, allowing yourself through the IntelliKey to become available to the extraordinary dimensions that each of you contains for the much larger life in body and mind and spirit. And the IntelliKey says, don't ask what the world needs. Ask what makes you come alive and go and do it. Because what the world needs is people, you who have come alive. You have come alive. Here we are in this new beginning. And with this essential self, knowing yourself so deeply loved, so cherished, nurtured, nourished, into the fullness of who and what you truly, truly are. Truly, truly are. You are becoming the possibility of real change. You are becoming the possibility of one who ignites the possibilities in all others. You are becoming the God seed blooming into the great butterfly. The butterfly in Greek is psyche. The great psyche who is in this world and time to bring the positive story, to bring the new way of being, to bring that which is beautiful, creative, fun. And with you, it's ideas that will hit the airwaves so that the entire planet can change its mind in hours. And remember what old Marianne says, our deepest fear is not that we're inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. It is our light, not our darkness, that most frightens us. And so you feel yourself being, loving, existing, being guided in the light. As Dante says, l'amore che muove il sole e l'altro stelle. The love that moves the sun and all the stars is the love which lights. And this is who you are. And this is what you are. And you have had the great fortune to have been born in the most critical time in human history. And being asked to rise, not just to the challenge, but to rise to the delight and the beauty and the sheer gorgeousness and the fun of it all, of being a true co-creator in alliance with the great, great spirit that lies within you. Yes? Yes. And you can repeat this process anytime, standing with the intellect, with the high being, who is who you are. If you'd like to sit down. So, indeed, my friends, here we are in the new decade of the millennium, yes? Beginning of the new year, the new decade, opportunity is everywhere, and obstacles commensurate with the great boons to be enjoyed. Yes, indeed. Let's take a few questions. Thoughts, ideas, harangues. Yes. The mic is coming your way. Ask and it shall be answered.
Can we have on this planet, on some media, 2 minutes of exquisite, exorbitant positivity? Why can't you do this? On ABC, CBS,
right now,
NBC,
2.5 million,
CNN.
Million emails are going out right now about something that I'm putting on the internet to, and you'll be seeing it,
okay.
Of this kind of thing in a 7-week course that costs almost nothing.
Yes, but I listen.
We've got to do more and more. And if you want to do it, it is the easiest thing in the world to do. Are you aware of that?
You
can create your own internet show. Why is it that Inside Edge doesn't have its own internet show? It's very inexpensive to do. You can do it. Look, it's not a question of being CNN or Fox News or that. People are finding in this new interconnectivity their new level. As the great civilizations grew up along the banks of the great rivers, yes? The Nile, the Yangtze, the Tigris, the Euphrates, yes? So a whole new civilization is growing out, growing up along the rivers of information, internet, the electronic rivers. You have access now to this question that's been asked by Barbara Marx Hubbard and everybody for 50 years. You have access now to put your own thoughts out. It is so easy to get your own internet show. And if enough of you do it, it becomes a great, great river.
Thank you, of course.
Start. Don't say, why not? It's you. Start. It's like the man who says, oh, God, 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 why don't you send anybody? It's such a terrible place. Why don't you send anybody? And God says, I did send somebody. I sent you. Other questions?
The Dalai Lama has said, he's predicted, that women in the Western Hemisphere will bring peace to the world. And Marianne Williamson has connected something called Sister Giant, in which she traces how Western women were squelched through all the witch hunts. And then we got the vote not that long ago. And in Africa, in Liberia, these women actually deposed a really wicked ruler.
That's right.
And elected the first woman president.
That's right, in Liberia.
Who is reelected.
That's right. And who had had tremendous hardship before she got to that role.
And it was a coalition of the Muslim and Christian women who really made the men pay attention. And so, all of us postmenopausal women with zest, my child is going to go to Pasadena next year, to Caltech, full ride. That means I won't have to be working my butt off to send him there, so I can put my energy toward really doing something.
You will do so. You
yes.
will do so. Now, to be perfectly honest, my friends in Africa and in Asia, my women friends, and in Japan, did not take entirely kindly to that remark of the Dalai Lama. It's going to be a bunch of European and Australian and American and Canadian women. But the reason he said that is because they have the education, they have the opportunity, they have reasonable wealth, they have freedom to do that. So wherever the energy goes, and it certainly is there, use it and do it. But I'm here to say it's also happening all over the world. And the beauty of it isn't against men. It is releasing men to be what they truly can be, you see. Thank you. Other thoughts? Yes.
Tell us how to change an organization such as education that is so stratified and so solidified that they don't understand that they are becoming prisons.
One of the things I'm going to ask you to do is you change your language about it. Let me give you my vision of education that works for everyone. I mean, I'm paraphrasing you right now. I see an education hands-on, sensory-rich, where art is central to the curriculum, where children dance and sing and drum and enact and play out and become visceral with their feelings and their education. I did this in Bangladesh in 50,000 schools that changed the education there. Put art, put culture back into the center of it. I see an education in which the children actually create moral covenants that they're going to live with, in which they actually are given real jobs to do in their societies. So as they learn things, they can then go out and, you know, test with the waters and the pollution and do all kinds of things. I see that. I see education where there's no such thing as a stupid child. There's no such thing as a stupid child. There's just children who need to cook on more burners and use more of themselves. As you talk the positives instead of the stratified obvious, you will find that it serves as a yeast in rising dough and more people begin to talk about it. But if you go at it from how lousy it all is, it doesn't work because it goes back into the negative trance that we happily go back into. We have to stop, my dear friends, we have to stop the negative trance. We really do. And that is with powerful stories, nothing succeeds better than a story. And start telling the new story. And tell it as if it were true. I have a friend who years ago, her name was Marilyn Ferguson, and years ago she ran the Brain Mind, wonderful document that came out. And years ago, she wrote a book called The Aquarian Conspiracy. In about 75, she talked about this great conspiracy, this new thing that was not happening, that was supposed to be happening. She was lying! It wasn't happening! But she told it as if it were, so everybody began to believe it, and you had the New Age come in. I mean, she believed it, but we all knew it wasn't happening. But the point is, you start telling the story, and you live it, and you dream it, and you write about it, and you keep telling the story, and it becomes the good news that then becomes the reality. You know where the word news comes from? North, east, west, and south. The whole thing, that's an acronym for that. Other questions? Yes.
Just a comment in reference to this lady's talk about Liberia. Some years ago, I read an authoritative report that said Liberia was at that time the most corrupt country on the face of the earth.
More child soldiers than anywhere.
And to have elected a woman president is really a first-class change. Just most people don't realize.
Oh, friends.
They don't even know where Liberia is, which is on the west coast of Central Africa.
There are so many first-class changes that are happening all over. Look for them. Talk about them. Tell your friends about them. Don't do the ain't it awful, have you seen it on the news today. Tell them. Yes, sir.
Thank you. a comment that invites comment. I'm reading two books right now, one by Philip Goldberg, who was a speaker here at the Inside Edge, called American Veda, about the influence of Hinduism and Vedic philosophy in America in the last 200 years. And then I'm also reading Keith Richards' biography, which is also about amazing change in the last, and I know Kathy, among others, appreciates that. And I was born in 1950. And what's happening in reading both of these books is, like, I realize I am unconscious as to what has gone on in my lifetime. And so I'm reading, and I'm, I mean, you know, where Keith Richards lived in London in 1955 was like 400 years ago. And what has gone on with the teachings that culminated in the Inside Edge 25 years ago is radical and extraordinary. So my empowerment of myself is that, well, I've been part of this change. I've been carried on it. I've been promoting it. But, you know, I've been playing this game for these many years up till now. And what I hear you say, if I appreciate the radical change that has gone on in the last 60 years, then I'm more empowered to keep going.
Thank you. We need the impetus of the positive and creative news. That 5 minutes means it's that we have left for more for questions. Good. Other thoughts? Yes, back there.
Question here.
Yes.
Thank you, Jean, so much for that process, that IntelliKey. That was one of the tangible ways for me to kind of shift out of the news. And I'm wondering if there's any other techniques or anything else you can suggest as we read about the 2 million fish here, the 100,000 birds here, the reality of the everyday stuff. How do we keep and deal with everyday stuff and like regular people, but yet be these IntelliKeys?
One of the things that you do, my friends, is that in that relationship with the IntelliKey, with this higher source of wisdom, you get led. You ask to be led, and you're led to things that you can actually do. And also you learn to balance your news between the 2,000 or 2 million fish with also the 2,000 children who are learning who weren't before, or with the incredible efforts in ecological safety, ecological help, so that you have balance. Without balance, you tend to die. You've got to have that. But with this higher leadership, and if you really want to know what you can do, come to mystery school. No, I mean, this is no joke, because I don't know that I'm going to do it again. But this year, it really is, what would you do if you knew you could not fail? And especially the first one that is coming up in February, where we get over the barriers of fear, what may have taken you years, and not you, but people years and years in therapy, in 1 weekend, we bring out the big stuff. So if you can come, and by the way, for this group only, what we're doing for each session is we are lowering the price by $175 tuition, less. And we are also, for anybody who wants to take the whole thing, the five that most people take, they take the whole mystery school, which is 5 sessions, we're lowering the price by $1,000. So, and this is now, you'll get a chance to sign up if you're interested. This is very important. I am terrible in marketing because I get very embarrassed, but I was with my dear friend Mary Morrissey today, and she was after me. So I'm going to tell you, this is a great mystery school. It will save you thousands of hours, and it will give you not only deep training and being able to incarnate the lives of great people so that you'll have some sense of their fertility of experience and the imaginal form, but you will also meet partners that you can work with in your projects and in your design. Please come to Mystery School. And it really is really something. And my friend, where is she? Yes. What are we going to do? And I'll take another question, but just so while you're here, she'll just tell you what we're going to do.
What we're going to do is give you an opportunity after this evening to meet in the library if you want to come and hear in more detail about Mystery School. This room is filled with people who have been to Mystery School and Social Outer Street. Just make yourself known. Just look around the room, okay? In 2000, when I met Jean, I knew that I was at a crossroads and I was looking for something. And I went to Mystery School, flew up every month with Patty and Jane, and my life has never been the same. And I think those of you who've been with Jean and Social Artistry and Mystery School would say that we would not be the people that we are if it wasn't for being with Jean. Would you all say? So I'm going to take registration. I'm going to take deposits tonight. I'm going to answer questions, talk to any of these people who have been with them and Jean and had their lives changed. And then we'll be in the library, little circle for you to talk a little bit more in depth about Mystery School. And she's going to be going teleconferencing in the future. This could be the last year that you'll be with her in person. As you could tell, there's no substitute for being in her presence, so I would take advantage of it while she's willing to show up instead of just doing it online.
Thank you so much. So you'll be there in the library, is that right?
Yeah,
Okay, and then you're going to take things. And this is the huge reductions that we're doing just for this group, for just for today. Thank you. All right, my friends, these are the times.
One more.
One more. Yeah. And?
Hi.
Where are the people? We better be.
I have a question. Yes. Really quick. It may seem off the beaten path, but an extraordinary thing happened in Rwanda. Not so much the million people that were killed in 100 days, but the reconciliation where they forgave, not only forgave, but reintegrated the people that murdered and maimed and hurt people in front of them. And they are joyous. I was wondering about your comment about that.
Well, I had something, little something to do with that, having trained some of those people who helped create the reconciliation. Everybody is yearning for reconciliation now. It is a massive movement in the world as we cross the great divide of otherness and really reach out to each other and feel not just the pain, but the glory, the God in hiding of each other. Reconciliation is happening not both in this kind of radical situation, but also in terms of the nations and the cultures of the earth. That's why I say, welcome to the most critical time in human history, and know the blessing that you are part of it. Okay. I think... No, we can't. You need a mic. You think you've got a built-in megaphone. What?
Well, as a mother of small children and here with a few friends who managed to escape and come to hear you, one of the challenges as a mother of small children is your day-to-day is so, you know, composed of practicalities. But I, doing the IntelliKey exercise, I walk through my days knowing that there is more that I can offer. And so I'm wondering if you might share a vision of what mothers can do in the world today, because our children are on such a threshold.
Mother's matrix, the source level, the ones who not only gestate and create, but who recreate, whose emphasis is on process rather than on product, on making things cohere, develop, and grow, whose inner subjective life should be equal to their outer life, and who in those times of holding the child have the great blessing of being so deeply empathic, and who bring to the child music, art, love, rhythm, adventure. You're living the full life. You are priests, priestesses, shamans of human becoming. Instead of pathologizing and saying, oy, what a life being a mother, let's re-mythologize it as the great souled teaching, evocation, quickening. You are midwives not just of children, but literally of all of society. For your inner and outer life comes together, and you bring the God seed into the world. With you. Thank you.